Good morning. Good seeing you here. We would like to start with Psalm 138, continue on with that psalm as we looked at a few things. First three verses, three verses about the praise of the Lord. Worship to the Lord and the cry to the Lord, and he answers. Pick up with verse 4, thinking about these verses and the things that are happening all around about us today, nationwide as well as worldwide. All the kings of the earth shall praise thee. That day is coming. All the kings of the earth shall praise thee, O Lord, when they hear the words of thy mouth. That's definitely not true about today, but that's about when the kingdom comes. Yea, they shall sing in the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. Though the Lord be high, yet he hath respect unto the lowly. That word respect, it carries the idea of he gives attention to those in the world that are lowly. But the proud, that is, those that exalt themselves, the proud, he knoweth afar off. He knows them from a distance. But the lowly he knows up close. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, thou wilt receive me. You shall stretch forth thine hand against the wrath of mine enemies. in thy right hand shall save or deliver me. The Lord's right hand delivers us. The Lord will perfect that which concerneth me. That means he'll bring it to completion. And we saw that in our Sunday school lesson this morning. Thy mercy, O Lord, endureth. It endureth forever. Forsake not the works of thine own hands. The word of the Lord. Great words. Man shall not live by bread alone, but man shall live by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. That's how we are to live. And all that reveals to us the importance of us teaching the word, being in the word, studying the word, and sharing what we find and what God teaches us with others. Let's go to number 65 to start our song service this morning. 65, the wonder of it all. If you would stand with me as we sing praise unto the Lord.
The wonder of sunset at evening. Oh, the wonder of sunrise I see. But the wonder of wonders that thrills my soul is the wonder that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. There's the wonder of springtime and harvest, the sky, the stars, the sun. But the wonder of wonders that thrills my soul is the wonder that's only begun. The wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me.
To pitch our mental tents on the love of God for each one of us. Not only am I important to God, but you are as well, and others in the world. Let's pray. Father, we come into your presence lifting our hearts, our voices, our total being in praise and thanksgiving to you. Father, for what you reveal to us about yourself in your word. Your love, grace and mercy that you extend. You don't just reveal it to us in word. You teach us that through the experiences of life as we walk, as we live. So many in the world that do not understand. They might hear the words and know the words, but they don't experience the grace, the mercy, and the love of God like we can by knowing you. Thank you, Father, for the day that you touched our hearts, opened our minds, made our allowed our eyes to see the wonders of our God. We give you thanks and praise for that. As we worship this day, may our worship be found acceptable in your sight. May our petitions to you through prayer, may they be heard in the courts of heaven. And Father, may your answers be brought to this earth, that you may change more lives of more people that are so desperately in need of hearing your word. And for all that you do, we'll praise and thank you for. Now through our prayers, eventually, Father, in your presence, we give you thanks. In the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, I pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Mark's going to come with some announcements.
First, Terry Jones wanted me to say, I know I said this last week, but again, since he's able to be here last Sunday morning, he had to work all night Saturday night, so he was sleeping. But he appreciates all the things that the church members brought so he could furnish his new apartment and also those that helped him move in. So he's very appreciative of that. And Jackie wanted me to let you all know she intended to be here, but she's got upper respiratory and she doesn't feel well because of that. But she's listening in, and she just wanted me to say how much she loves this church family of hers and how much she appreciates everybody in their prayers. By way of announcements, tonight at 6:45, we'll continue starting in Numbers chapter 11. And I'm just doing something simple for tonight if you want to come to eat. I'm just picking up pizzas. And then on Wednesday night, we'll start in Ezekiel 40. Now, some people might have panicked when in Wednesday night's Bible study and then the email where I mentioned homework, especially if you haven't been to school with a while. Most people don't like to hear the word homework. But, of course, I wasn't talking about where you had to write something down or answer questions. But it's a 7-minute video because it'll tie into what we'll be studying, Ezekiel chapters 40 through 48, those last 9 chapters. And it's a 3D computer-generated model of what the blueprint of the that was given from God to Ezekiel about the temple that will exist during the millennial kingdom. And as I mentioned in the email, the woman who's doing this, she has a very strong accent, but there are English subtitles to help you along there. It just myself personally, it helps me to visualize it, because otherwise studying all those dimensions to try to see that all in your head. So I think it's helpful. Some of you may even want to watch it more than once, but anyway, it's there for those who are interested. And Diane always brings something really good, so we appreciate that. I think that's all for now. Thank you.
Oh, I was just thought crossed my mind, and I'm sure all of you know already, but I just want to mention that Sophie had her baby and doing well. And there's always something special about the first one. The firstborn. It just is something special. And God has put it that way. And new things that the parents now are going to be experiencing, first time experiences. So we'll want to uphold her in prayer, and well as her husband and the baby, and look for great things that God's going to do in those lives. Let's go to 97. All hail the power of Jesus' name. If there's a name that has any power to it, it's his name. Far greater than any here on earth. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall, bring forth the royal diadem, and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem, and crown him Lord of all. Ye chosen seed of Israel's race, ye ransomed from the fall. Hail him who saves you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saves you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. Let every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial ball, to him all majesty ascribe, and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe, and crown him Lord of all. Oh, that with yonder sacred throng we at his feet may bow, we'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all. We'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all. Amen. Amen. 102, just a few pages over. Thinking, continue our thoughts on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we are to pray and petition the heavens. There's something about that name. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. Now 103, blessed be the name. All praise to him who reigns above in majesty supreme, who gave his son for man to die, that he might man redeem. Oh, blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. On the second His name above all names shall stand, exalted more and more. At God the Father's own right hand, where angels hosts adore. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. On the third, His name shall be the Counselor, the Mighty Prince of Peace, of all earth's kingdoms conqueror, whom reign shall never cease. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Jerry, if you would, please.
Good morning. We've come together to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. May everything we do, everything we say, everything we think be to that end. May we honor and glorify Him in all that we do. Just want to say, I thought we would, they're not here yet, but I thought we would be experiencing two people kind of floating in the air this morning. The birth of we're just so thankful that everything went well and enjoy this time together. Ken has already mentioned some things about it. I want to just bring before your attention the ones that we've been praying for some time. Janet still with her physical problems with her foot. Mike and Janie with the situations that they're going through. Phil with his cancer treatment. The people in Ukraine, we just pray for their safety. A lot of people were killed last night with missile attacks on an army base. But just pray that this aggression will stop. And then we want to continue to pray for families who have lost loved ones that are in our fellowship. Praise for something that for which we've been praying that the Lord has answered in a very positive way. Joel Westbrook was able to get the truck that he needed for transportation, and we're thankful for that. We have some Don and Sharon are on their way back up from Florida up here, coming and traveling today. So we want to pray for their journey mercies as they come. Harris's sister Betty is back in the hospital having breathing problems, and is having the possibility of some problems with the medicine that she's taking. So I pray that'll be taken care of. Well, the boys are here, but see the other couple, the other ones, huh? So the boys are going to have to learn to behave themselves, I guess. let's see. And then Mary wants us to remember her situation with her body. There's some things that need to be taken care of, some decisions that need to be made. And then I announced in Sunday school that Jeff Baldwin's grandmother was seriously ill with kidney failure, but they wanted us to pray for her that her passing might go peacefully, and she did go peacefully last night. And so we just ask that you would remember that family in prayer. Are there other things that you want to bring before us? Ken?
I got communication from James in Africa, and James says everything's going well with the Avoquas and that. He said prices on everything, just like here, just going up continually.
James in Africa, okay.
And then also Maxwell in Malawi has sent word. He'd like a special prayer going on because they got a storm that's going to move in and dump a bunch of rain again.
Again?
Yeah. So who knows, they may end up with flooding again.
Yeah. So Maxwell wants prayer because another storm is coming in. They've just experienced a real problem with flooding and loss of their crops, so that they may have more trouble. So we want to continue remembering them. Let's see. I believe that's it. I've asked Mark if he would lead us in prayer after our Bible reading this morning. Man today looks everywhere for his help, except for the one that can provide the help, the one that is able. Listen to the scriptures. O Lord, I am oppressed. Undertake for me. Unto thee lift I up mine eyes. O thou that dwellest in the heavens, behold, as the eyes of the servants look unto the hand of their masters, and as the eyes of the maiden unto the hand of her mistress, so our eyes wait upon the Lord our God. Hear my cry, O God, attend unto my prayer. For the end of the earth will I cry unto thee when my heart is overwhelmed. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. For thou hast been a shelter for me, a strong tower from the enemy. I will abide in thy tabernacle forever. I will trust in the covert of thy wings. Thou hast been a strength to the poor, a strength to the needy in his distress, a refuge from the storm. Christ suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow his steps, who did no sin. Neither was guile found in his mouth, who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously. May we look to the Lord.
Our Father, we thank you for this morning hour. We thank you, Lord, that we come boldly to the throne of grace. We acknowledge, Lord, who you are, holy. You are Yahweh, the Elohim of all Elohim. And Father, for these prayer requests, we lift up to you. And Father, we think of Jackie and the loss of her son. We pray, Lord, you give her comfort and a family during this ongoing time. We think of Jeff and the loss of his grandmother. Father, we pray that they would sense your comfort. We think of Don and Sharon as they travel back from Florida, that you'd watch over them and give them safety. We also think of Bob and his upcoming tests. Lord, we pray that you'd give wisdom to the doctors as they conduct these tests. And Father, we thank you for all the love, mercy, and grace to us. We thank you for this assembly. We thank you for the unity that we have here and the love that we have. And Father, we think of the Ukrainian people. Lord, we think of what they are going through. And Father, we pray that this conflict would come to an end. We pray, Lord, that your hand would be upon that and we could see your hand at work. And Father, we pray for the leadership of this country, that you would lead them to righteousness. And now, Father, as we look to to this hour, we pray for our pastor. We pray, Lord, for him. We ask that you put a hedge of protection around him as he ministers us in truth and in spirit. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Men will come forward. We'll receive our morning offering.
Okay, sorry.
Could the mic be up just a little bit more for me? Sorry.
I should have come earlier. Okay, thank you. I appreciate it, John. Jackie Arnold requested that I sing this song this morning. And I first want to read the words because, in case my diction is not good enough for you to hear them, it starts out, "Weak and wounded sinner, lost and left to die. Oh, raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus. Come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away. and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. Like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. Remember, when you walk, sometimes you fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus and live. Sometimes the way is lonely and steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours like rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. Oh, when the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus and live. And with your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye. Then go in peace and laugh on glory's side. And fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live.
Weak and wounded sinner, lost and left to die. Oh, raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus. Come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. Like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. Remember, when you walk, sometimes you fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus. Sometimes the way grows lonely and steep and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. Oh, when the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain the joy inside, then dance for Jesus, dance for kiss this world goodbye, then go in peace and laugh on glory's side and fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live. Fly to Jesus.
Romans chapter 7. Romans chapter 7. Let's pray. Father, again, we're thankful for so many things. We're thankful for our salvation, that the Lord Jesus Christ thought it not robbery to stay there at your right hand, but took upon the human flesh and dwelt here on the earth and experienced things that we experience, one of them being when loved ones leave here and go home to be with you. But through all of this, Father, we're thankful that you give us your word, which comforts us and encourages us and gives us strength. So we pray for that this morning. Give us what we need, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. So we continue in Romans chapter 7, picking up where we left off last week. As Paul is inspired, he continues the same subject. Know ye not? There are several particular phrases about Paul that are common. One of them is, I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren. That he uses that one a lot. So know ye not is the old English. We typically in modern English, don't you know? And it's sort of a reminder because he knows they do know, these believers in Rome. Know ye not, brethren. He is talking to them and all believers. Lost people aren't included in this. Know ye not, brethren, and then he says parenthetically, for I speak to them that know the law. So in particular, at least the Jewish people, the Jewish believers knew this. He says, how that the law has dominion over a man as long as he lives. Now he's going to give a literal example of that. For instance, I'll just say it before we read it, but in the case of in a marriage, I think it's best to read it and then let's do it that way. Verse 2. For the woman which has a husband is bound by the law to her husband so long as he lives. All right, and it's going to explain to us though, if her husband dies, she's free to remarry without committing adultery. But if he's still alive, then it's committing adultery. Now, Jesus speaks specifically about this, and I think he gives one exception to it. But so with that in mind, going on in verse 2, he says, but if the husband be dead, she is loosed from the law of her husband. Now, why is Paul bringing this example about a marriage? Why they're free to remarry without committing adultery if he's dead? Because in the example of the law, in believing in the Lord Jesus Christ, we've been freed from the law. This was something that many of the Jewish believers who did believe but had trouble understanding this. Paul referred to them as Judaizers. They were the ones that We're claiming that if you're a believer, telling these Gentile believers that you need to be circumcised and you need you can't eat certain kind of meat and so forth and so on. So this is the thing to keep in mind, what it means. Because remember, he spent a lot of time talking about we're dead in Christ. So if we're dead in Christ, then there shouldn't be that. There is that, but as I mentioned, the two sides of the coin. But let's go on, verse 3. He says, so then, if while her husband lives, she be married to another man, she'll be called an adulteress. But if her husband be dead, she is free from the law, so that she is no adulteress, though she be married to another man. So once he died, then she's no longer bound to that, to the marriage that she once had. And we are no longer bound, if we're believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, which who he's writing to, we're not bound to the law. He's going to use the word married again in a moment to fit the description. Look at verse 4. Wherefore, connecting what he just said, my brethren, again, us as believers, you also are become dead to the law. So that same idea, the analogy of the woman's husband dying, she's free to remarry because he's dead. So it says ye, that you plural, as Paul's saying, that's us, also are become dead to the law by the body of Christ. So when we talked about the idea of what baptism represents as being crucified in Christ, buried in Christ, so that means we're dead, that sin nature we are born with, and raised in newness of life. And he goes on in verse 4, yet that ye should be married to another. There's the word married again. So you see the analogy here that he's giving. So we should be married to him in that sense. We should be faithful to him. It says, to him who is raised from the dead, that we should bring forth fruit to God. Now it's easy when you see the word should or might, you know it's subjunctive. What it means is we might produce fruit. It doesn't mean it's automatic. Either we're producing fruit or we're not producing fruit to God. There's also the fruit of unrighteousness, and we're capable of producing that if we are being enslaved to that sin instead of being married to him as believers and bringing forth this fruit. So verse 5, for when we were in the flesh, the motions of sins, which were by the law, the word motions meaning like the passions, the affections, that's how it's translated in the King James and Galatians, the affections, it's the emotions, you could say. But so it says the motions in verse 5, the motions of sins which were by the law. Remember, you have to remember what he meant by that. It's not that sin didn't exist before the law came, right? But according to Scripture, it wasn't imputed unto them. It wasn't counted against them until it was specifically spelled out. And so that's what it means by the law. Did work, this passion for sin, the emotions or affections, did work in our members to bring forth fruit unto death. All right, now he's going to contrast this coming up. Now verse 6, but now we're delivered from the law. The fact that we are dead in Christ, that in the idea of we've been placed in Christ, buried in him, so we should be dead to sin. That again is the way God's looking at it, looking down at us. And it's reality, but there's the other side of the coin. So we're going to get to that at the end of this chapter, the whole second half. All right, so we're delivered from, another word for delivered, we're freed. Just like the woman whose husband died, she can remarry without being committing adultery. So we go on in verse 6. It says, I'll read again, but now we are delivered from the law, that being dead, wherein we were held. This idea of held is imprisoned, enslaved to, that we should serve in newness of spirit. You see the word should, so again, it's subjunctive. It doesn't mean automatically because you're a Christian, you're going to always be serving him and never serving sin. That's what Paul's trying to say we need to do, it's what we should do. But notice, should serve, again, that same attitude of servitude, instead of being in bondage or enslaved to sin, we should, as believers, be in bondage or enslaved to God. So it says, in newness of spirit. Now, we know that there's several things Paul brings out in this chapter. But the idea of the old man, when we were lost, that's the only thing we had. We could only serve sin. We could never, a lost person cannot be pleasing to God. They don't have the spirit. Nothing doesn't mean a lost person can't do good things, but none of them count. So as believers, it doesn't mean because we're saved now that we're always going to do what God wants us to do, that we're always going to produce fruit, because that old man, that sin nature we are born with, is still very much alive. And we have to actively work. And that's coming up, getting ahead of myself of what Paul teaches here. But the newness of the Spirit, and notice how it's contrast, and not the oldness of the letter. Now think about the new and the old. The old of the letter means the written law. The Old Testament, under the law. Now the newness of Spirit. Notice, contrast the opposite, newness and oldness. Now, holding your place in Romans 7, turn ahead just to Romans 12 for a moment. I know that we're all familiar with this passage, but I didn't think it hurts to look at it and be reminded. And I want us to get to verse 2, but we'll start in verse 1. So Romans chapter 12, verse 1. I beseech you, I beg, I entreat, very strongly asking, therefore, brethren, therefore connecting to what's been said, but it's again to us, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. And when you put the words living and sacrifice next to each other, it seems like they're contradictory terms. A sacrifice was something that died. They sacrificed the animal. The animal had to die. So how can our body be a living sacrifice? Well, think of it. It's the both sides of the coin. The idea that he counts us dead, or buried in Christ, dead to sin. That's the sacrifice part. A living sacrifice, though it's a sacrifice, still alive. All right, let's go on to see what he says. A living sacrifice, holy, that means set apart, different, as God is holy. Acceptable, again in the Greek, meaning well-pleasing to God. Not all Christians are well-pleasing to God. It says, which is your reasonable, or you could say appropriate, service. Now, verse 2, and be not conformed. That word, if you think of the word form there, but the idea, if you were making jello and you poured it into a particular kind of mold, and then when the jello set and you dumped it out, it would be that mold. So it is like that, the idea of conforming to this world. So don't do that. Why would he tell us that if it's all automatic, that once we get saved, we don't need to worry about that? We do need to be concerned about it. We need to make sure we're not conforming ourselves to this world. But instead, it says, instead of that, be ye transformed. And you think about the word transformation, the idea of a change. You know, there's some, we see this in nature sometimes. I was thinking about the caterpillar, right? And then it makes a cocoon. And later it comes out, it's still got sort of the body of the caterpillar, but it has wings. It's a different stage of life, but it transforms in the cocoon. So think about our lives as Christians in that sense, that we're in a cocoon and should be transforming, but it's not automatic. When we get to the judgment seat of Christ, we'll find out if we got our wings, so to speak. Did we change, or did we stay the same? Be transformed, how? By the renewing. It's the same form of the word. It's slightly different, but it's the same form of the word that we see in Romans 7, the newness. The renewing implies, you see, it's a participle. It's got ing. It's not something that happens instantly. It would be nice, right, if we got saved and instantly we were totally transformed in the sense that we're now only pleasing God and we don't have to worry about sin anymore. But it's a process. And either the process is happening or it's not. So, we're instructed here to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Now, when you think about the mind, right, most people, when they talk about a human being, they talk about mind and body. Well, that makes sense. But the scripture makes a distinction, Hebrews 4:12, makes a distinction between two parts of our mind, the spirit and the soul. As a lost person, according to scripture, our spirit was dead. That means our God consciousness. Until we're saved, we're not reconciled to God. There is no pleasing of God possible for a lost person. They don't have the Holy Spirit. All they have is that part of their mind called the soul that wants to please self. That's what there is. Now, because we're saved, we have the Spirit of God. We can say yes to God or no to God. And then the opposite of that. We can say yes to self or no to self. We can please whatever desire we want, or we can choose to be pleasing to God and do what he wants. So the renewing of your mind, we need to get in the Word and have a new way of thinking, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable, again, well-pleasing and perfect will of God. It's all here. We just go in and get it. Now come back to Romans 7, if you will, and we'll continue then in this idea. So in verse 6 again, Romans 7:6. But now we're delivered from the law, and being dead wherein we were held, that we should serve. So we do or we don't, but the purpose is so we're able to, in other words, serve in newness of spirit and not in the oldness of the letter. He continues, verse 7, with this question. What shall we say then? He does this a lot in Romans, repeatedly. Because he is trying to go through it in his mind, I think this is what you might call logic, and say, in each case, this might be the response of somebody. Well, and so that's why he brings up the question. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? That's, somebody might conclude, okay, if it weren't for the law, sin wouldn't have been pointed out. It would never have been imputed or counted towards us. So does that make the law bad? Is there something wrong with the law in that respect? Is the law sin? Notice the answer, God forbid. It's a stronger in the Greek, right? In no way may it never be. God forbid. Nay, old English word for no, right? We don't say nay much anymore, but nay, I had not known sin but by the law. So the law had its purpose. Paul says, for I had not known lust. Now, I have no idea why the translators, I'm going to show three words to you. They translated all three different, and it's from the same Greek word. The word lust, the last word of this verse 7, covet, and in verse 8, concupiscence. Now, if you're looking at a different translation, it hopefully has them corrected as what they are from the Greek. But this word lust is that desire, that covetousness, the want. So he said, for I had not known lust, except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. That's just one example. He's using that one. The tenth commandment, thou shalt not covet. Unless in the Roman church they split that one into the ninth and tenth commandment, and take the second commandment and tuck it in under the first, whereas thou shalt have no graven images. Anyway, that's not part of the message, but I just wanted to point that out. So he's using that one as an example. The law pointed out what lust or covetousness was, that want. All right, so he's saying that's the purpose of the law. He talks about it elsewhere in his letters. But verse 8, but sin, taking occasion by the commandment, right? Think about a list of rules, right? And don't do this and don't do that. That's thou shalt not. Don't do, don't do, don't do. Keep that all in mind as we get to the second half of the chapter. All right? So the sin then, taking occasion, an opportunity by the law, wrought, that means worked or produced in me all manner of concupiscence. Again, it's the same Greek word covetousness, that you see the word lust in verse 7 if you're looking at the King James. Same word. All manner. For it says, for without the law, sin was dead. And again, he's already pointed out, didn't mean that sin didn't exist before the law came. But he's trying to make that point. Now, verse 9, he's using himself as an example. Verse 9, for I, Paul says, was alive without the law once in his past. Remember, he was called Saul of Tarsus. And he was a very devout Jew. In fact, he believed he was doing the right thing by arresting Christians. I know they didn't call them Christians yet until Antioch, but he was arresting them and having them killed. We know Stephen was stoned to death. So he said, I was alive without the law once, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died. Now, so we think about once that was pointed out, in that sense, we see this death that occurs. And by the way, here's a good example, because people ask, because they say, what scripture can you use to show that babies will be in heaven? An unborn baby, because life begins at conception, or a young infant, how can you know they're going to be in heaven? Because here's a good example in this verse. At what point did this spiritual death occur? It's when it was pointed out to him, and then sin revived and he died. So, you know, if you talk about an unborn baby or an infant, this is not possible. So I like to say, rather than call them lost, they're safe. Until a person hears the gospel, understands what they hear, and reject it, they're not lost yet. Anyway, verse 10. And the commandment which was ordained to life, I found to be unto death. The purpose of the law was ordained, it says here, to life. That's what it was meant for. But he found it instead. What it brought about was death. Verse 11, he keeps explaining. For sin, and I put emphasis on the word sin, just to show you he's using, that is the what caused this, not the law. For sin taking occasion by commandment, we just read that a couple of verses before. Sin, again, took occasion, taking occasion by the commandment, deceived me. You know who the Bible says the deceiver is? Deceived me, and by it slew me. There again is that he died. Not physically, but in the sense of spiritual death. Verse 12, wherefore the law is holy. He's doing all this part to say, it's not the law that's bad. It had its purpose. The law is holy, and the commandment holy and just, means it's fair, and it's good. All right, now we get to verse 13. So here's the next question. Was then that which is good made death to me? Right, because somebody said, okay, so you prove that the law wasn't bad, it had its purpose, and it was good. But did somehow that, the law, which was good, make him die? Again, he says, God forbid. But sin, he's again, this emphasis on the sin. But sin, that it might appear sin, you know, manifest itself, show what it really is, working, again, this word producing death in me, by that which is good. Again, the law is good, right? But he mentioned in verse 9, once the commandment was given, sin revived, he said, and I died. Going on at verse 13, that sin by the commandment might become exceeding sinful. To point out what sin is and how bad sin is. Verse 14, for we know, there's the expression again, this is, if we don't know it, he's reminding us as believers. He includes himself when he says we. For we know that the law is spiritual, right? But, he said, I am carnal, sold under sin. Think about the carnal is fleshly or worldly. So the difference between the spiritual and the physical. So now these next verses, 15 and following, I used to read these and it just seemed like, what is he trying to say? So I'll hopefully, with God's help, we'll try to go through this and hopefully make it clear in our minds. Verse 15, he uses the word for because he's continued to talk about the same subject. He said, that which I do, this word do in the Greek doesn't mean just a one-time doing, but it's continually happens, not every second, but happens throughout his life. That which I do, I allow not. Now, the word allow here it's a kenosis in the Greek word, so it means to know or understand. He couldn't quite get a grasp on why this is. Why does he say that? For what I would means what I wanted. What I wanted to do, that's what he means, that do I not. The things that he wanted to do to please God, he often found himself not doing. And then the opposite, he said, but what I hate, what I know to be wrong and should not be done, he says, that I do, or that do I. I find myself doing that. Now, I think about those who, as I mentioned this last week too, the preachers and Bible teachers that are out there saying that once you get saved, it's an instant thing as far as you're dead to sin, so you can't serve sin anymore. And if you're still serving sin, you didn't really get saved. That's usually the explanation. So think about that for a second, because if you carry that through, that implies that there are certain Christians who think they are never serving sin in their life. So I don't know, there isn't anybody like that according to 1 John chapter 1. There's nobody that always does the right thing and never does anything wrong. So if they come to that conclusion, somehow they're justifying something in their life that is apparently okay. But, well, that person, no, they're still serving sin. They have to be lost. That's none of that scriptural. Remember, our being saved or lost has nothing to do with how good or bad we are. Right? The whole purpose of the law was to prove that no one could keep the law. If you offend in one, you offend in all. So, what I think about, though, this is the Apostle Paul. He wrote a majority of the New Testament. And he had this struggle. This is part of the Christian life. Now, as he brings out, we know Galatians 5, not every Christian is really struggling with this, as he calls the spiritual warfare. Because if you're just given in to self and whatever self wants, there's no battle going on. You've completely just shut off and said no to God and do whatever. It doesn't mean that person's lost. It doesn't mean they were saved and got lost. It just means they're a carnal Christian. And when I say just, I don't mean by that it's okay to be carnal. But we will all find out at the judgment seat, in the end, when excuse me, when this life is over, in the end, what will be the result of our lives? Will we be found having lived a life just serving sin and saying no to God? Or, as we talk about is the parable of the talents, well done, thou good and faithful servant. So it's not automatic. We either will or we won't. But these are the struggles that we will have in our Christian lives. All right, verse 16, he continues. If then I do that which I would not, in other words, I find myself doing the things that I don't want to do, he says, I consent to the law that is good. Excuse me. Because it points out, law pointed out what sin was. So that's an acknowledgement that the law is good. Verse 17. So then he says, now then it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwells in me. Now that it doesn't mean to say, let's say somebody commits a heinous crime and said, well, I didn't do it, it was some part of me or something. It doesn't let somebody off the hook for something that they actually committed. But he's trying to make a point here. What is in us that causes us to serve sin? And this is what he continues to explain. He notices this, and he's going to talk when we get to verse 21. The word law here means principle. He finds this principle that is true about us as believers. So, verse 17, I'll read again. Then it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwells in me. So even though we're saved and we've been buried in Christ, raised to newness of life, and the other side of the coin, in reality for us or in a practical way, sin is still there. It's very much alive. Now, none of us have the same infirmity, so to speak. And God knows us more than anybody else knows us. Satan also does, too. And, you know, I often think about, as Jerry was reading in Ephesians 6 today, in the parts of the armor, you know, it starts with truth. The loins girt about with truth. If we don't know the truth of the Word of God, that's where Satan can get in there and deceive us. Because he knows what we know. And he can use that to his advantage and to our disadvantage. All right, so sin is a reality. Paul says, this is the apostle saying, sin dwells in me. That sin nature I was born with is there. It's very much alive. It's living there. Verse 18. For I know that in me, and then he specifies parenthetically, that is in my flesh, in his physical body, in me dwells no good thing. Think about that. That's the reason that not one lost person can do any good as far as God's concerned. They can't. In ourselves, apart from God, there is nothing good about us. So think about how Satan uses that. If a Christian doesn't know that, Satan will whisper to us and say, you know you can't do that. Who do you think you are? Whatever it is he's trying to get us to not do, he's trying to get us. You know, and I used to, as a young person, and I thought, man, I'm not any good. But then when I realized that's the truth of the word, then Satan can't get me there anymore, because I can say, that's right, there is no good in me. I myself, apart from God, can do nothing that counts for good. And once we know that, he can no longer attack you there. He'll find some other way, but he'll keep working. Ooh, time is going fast. Okay. So, I'll read verse 18 again. For I know that in me, Paul says, that's in my flesh, dwells no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I find not. The word will means the desire. The desire to do what God wants me to do is there, but for some reason he finds himself sometimes not doing that. It's a frustrating thing, but he's talking about the reality. Yes, we should serve God, bringing fruit to him, but the reality is we got to remember there's something we have to deal with on a daily basis, and that is our sin nature. By the way, when it says, for to will is present with me, remember in the Garden of Gethsemane, and Peter, James, and John went with him there. It was the night that at 1 o'clock in the morning, Judas Iscariot says, the one I kiss will be him, and they're all standing there, the Roman soldiers, to arrest Jesus. But for that first hour, from midnight to 1, he told Peter, James, and John to pray. I'm going to go over here and pray. And he kept coming back and falling them asleep. Well, you say, man, did they not realize the urgency of the hour? No, they really didn't. And they were apostles, three of the closest to Jesus. They really didn't understand. And yes, they were tired. Most of us, unless you're a person that stays up late, most people are asleep at midnight. And that's what they kept doing. But remember in the end, the third time when he comes back, he said, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. It's the same thing Paul here is talking about. Paul wanted to do what's right. The spirit is willing, But self often gets in the way. Self wants to please the flesh. You think about that when it talks about the spirit and soul in our mind, either it is or it isn't happening. But if we want to be pleasing to God, there's a battle going on over control of the body. Do we say yes to God and let him control us? Then we're instruments of righteousness. Or do we say yes to self and let our bodies be used as instruments of unrighteousness? So let's go on. Got 2 minutes. Verse 19. He said, for the good that I would not, the good that I want to do, I find myself not doing. But the evil which I would not, the bad things I don't want to do, that I do. Now, Paul doesn't mean by this is everything in his life. But he's trying to point out to us that this is a constant thing he deals with. And it should be for us too. And I say should be, because if it's not a battle, that's a bad sign for us as Christians. If there's no battle going on and we're having to fight, then that's not a good thing. Verse 20. Now if I do that, I would not, do the things that I don't want to do. It is no more I that do it, but sin that dwells in me. He repeats that again. That's what's causing it. Verse 21. I find then a law. And the word law here doesn't mean like the law of the Old Testament. It means a principle. This is a fact that he realized. When I would do good, when I want to do what is right, evil is present with me. The evil referring to that sin. That sin nature we're born with is still there. Even when we're doing what is right, it's still there. It doesn't leave us. Verse 22, he said, for I delight in the law of God after the inward man. Now, this is the first time he uses that phrase, the inward man. Here, I believe, referring to the new nature that we have now as believers. Verse 23, but I see another law in my members, again, talking about our physical bodies, warring against the law of my mind. So this inward man, this new nature, he's calling the law of his mind. It wants to be pleasing to God, but the law of the members, the flesh, or self, wants to be pleasing to self. It says, and bringing me into captivity, it imprisons. That's why the word bondage or enslaved. A person can be enslaved, and Paul's not talking about lost people here, but Christians can be enslaved to sin, be in captivity, be in prison to that. It says, to the law of sin, which is in my members. Now, if you'll permit me, because it's time to stop, but I'd like to finish the next two verses. Now, after all that, somebody might say, as Paul says here, oh, wretched, which means miserable. What a miserable man that I am. I'm glad he didn't stop there. But he's acknowledging that that's where we could come to and say, just despair. That we're, how can we ever be pleasing to God? We've got this sin nature to deal with. But just the next part of the verse. He asks the question, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? Now here, he's talking about not physical death or spiritual death. He's already a believer. But he's talking about what I like to call solical death. That is not having life in the coming age. That death. So, the one that can deliver us is Jesus Christ. So, because it asked, who can deliver us from the body of this death? Verse 25, I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. It is through him that we can, as was in the Sunday school lesson, overcome or be more than conquerors. We can overcome it, but it's not automatic. He is there for us. He wants to help us to say yes to God and no to self. But we have to realize it's a battle. And we'll close with the end of verse 25. So then, he sums up all that he's been talking about. With the mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. So which one are we individually as believers going to yield to? That's the question. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word today and reminding us of these things. Help us, Father, to, in the spiritual warfare, in the struggle, in the fight, the battle between being pleasing to you or being pleasing to ourselves, give us the strength to say no to self and yes to you. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Mark. Book of Romans deals with some real tough problems in life, and we all face those problems. What's the solution? 349. Trust and obey. You would stand with me? All together.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust. No other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Okay, let's close in prayer. Father, we're thankful today for the fellowship we can have together in your word and for those listening in. If it be your will, Father, we pray that we would be able to return together to fellowship. Help us to be ready when our Lord Jesus Christ returns, that we might hear, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." Father, this is our prayer. Go with us our separate ways. Watch over us. Please keep us safe. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. I thought all the proceeds go to those two.